Hello students, this is Anil Kumar Panda, lecturer of Electrical Engineering, DREAMS Cuttack. For the next 30 minutes, I will be with you on this topic, static relay. This comes from the subject, switchgear and protective devices. This is one of the subject of Electrical Engineering of 6th semester, and this static relay is the last chapter. So in this static relay, there are three contents: advantages of static relay, instantaneous overcurrent relay, and principle of idiomatic relay. Only there are three contents. So before going into the chapter, let me say, what do we mean by a relay? A relay is a very important part in our switchgear and protective devices, because this is the important part which senses the fault whenever there is a problem like overcurrent, overvoltage, or any type of fault which happens in a power system. So this is the first thing which senses the fault and addresses or commands the circuit breaker to operate. Next. But our chapter is static relay. So what is static relay? In this static relay, all the components, whatever we use, all the components are static. There is no movement part. There is no moving part. There is no armature and no moving part. All the systems are static. And these are made up of either electronic, magnetic, or in the form of microprocessors. So apart from that, all the solid state components, whatever we use, this consist of resistors, capacitors, and some magnetic circuit. The comparators and the measurements are all done by the static components. So as this is a static component, and this is totally different from the relays we use, conventional relay, because in those relays there are moving parts, but in this relay there is no moving parts. All are static, they don't move at all. So this is one of the advantages. For this, in your contents, the first content goes into what are the advantages of static relay. Why we go for static relay? Now the static relays are in demand, but why we go for static relay? There are so many advantages. So first thing is that the static relay consumes very, very less power in comparison to our conventional relay. Apart from that, due to this less consumption of power, there is very less burden on the instruments, measuring instruments, whatever is connected with those relays. After that, coming to the second point, the static relay gives a very fast response, very quick response, and it is longer life, has very high reliability, and also shock proof. There is no electrical shock we can get from that, because those are printed circuit boards and easily made. If they are made in manufacturing, they can be mass production and have longer life. Then third thing is the reset time of the relay is very less. It is one of the advantages. As in other relays, dynamic relays, for reset it takes some time, much more time than the static relays. Then coming to the absence of moving contacts and associated problems of arcing, contact bounce, erosion, replacement of contacts. The relay amplifies the input signal, which also increases their sensitivity. The chance of unwanted tripping is less in this relay. The static relay can easily operate in earthquake prone areas because they have high resistance to shock. So these are all the advantages of the static relay, so which are now in demand. So this is question most often comes in your exam. What are the advantages of static relay? So please note it down for your exam. Then coming to instantaneous overcurrent relay. Instantaneous overcurrent relay, whatever relay we are going to discuss now are all static relay, are the forms of static relay. Because this instantaneous overcurrent relay is also there in dynamic relay, but we are not going into dynamic part. We will consider only the static part. So instantaneous overcurrent relay, what are the various parts, what are their functions? So here, as you can see, this is current transformer, CT. Current transformer, the input from the current transformer is supply to the auxiliary CT with filter. Now before going into details into this subject, let me clarify that the whole function of this relay is to sense the fault, whether there is a fault or not. If there is a fault, then the relay will work, it will sense it, and it will direct the circuit breaker or the tripping circuit to work. So here, whether there is abnormal current or fault current, so this measurement is done by the current transformer. So this is the input from the current transformer and it's given to the auxiliary CT. Auxiliary CT is an additional current transformer which is connected with filter, which helps the current transformer to measure the accurate value of current. There are other terms which are associated with it, that is pickup value current. At what current it should decide that this is a fault current, that is pickup fault current, and this measurement can be done by the tappings which is provided in the auxiliary CT, auxiliary current transformer. After that, it is provided to the bridge rectifier. As we know, the function of the rectifier is to convert AC to DC. So here, as it is a static component, here the DC value is measured and the output of the DC is given to the zero level detector. So what is zero level detector? So this is a comparison device. It consists of resistors, capacitors. This is a comparison device. Potentiometers are being connected here. There is a preset value over there. It measures, it compares. It compares the input current with the preset current already there in the potentiometer, which is already present in the zero level detector. So it compares the input current with the threshold current, which is already have in the potentiometer. There is adjustment. So it compares the input current with the threshold current. If the input current is more than the threshold current, then it gives it gives response to the amplifier. If it is less than the threshold current, then there is no output. Output is zero. If the input current is more than the threshold current, which has been determined already in the preset value of the zero level detector, if that input current is more than the threshold current, then it gives output or response to the amplifier. The function of the amplifier is to enhance the signal. Because here there is CT, then we are dealing with auxiliary CT, the level of current is very low. So that low current is been compared here with the preset value of the potentiometer. Then it is if the input current is more than the threshold value, that value is provided to the amplifier. The function of the amplifier is to enhance the current. So the increased current is given to the output circuit. And of course, the output circuit may be connected with a circuit breaker or any tripping circuit, which trips the circuit at that moment. So this is all about instantaneous overcurrent relay. The name instantaneous means these are very fast, very quick. And whenever there is a fault, in the power system, instantly it works. That is why it is known as instantaneous overcurrent relay. It does not take any time. It does not take any time to, it does not delay, does not take any time for the, give any time to the protective devices for the fault current to remain with, as it is there in other relay which we are going to discuss later, that is definite time relay. So this is instantaneous overcurrent relay. So in this relay, it does not take time. If there is fault current, instantly it works. So this is all about instantaneous overcurrent relay. Thereafter, so whatever I have said, have all been written in this slide, so that you can note it down and can prepare for exam. Let me call it out. Coming to the second point, the output of the CT, here you can find the CT, this is your CT, current transformer. The output of the CT is fed to an auxiliary current transformer, whose output is rectified, smoothened and supplied to the measuring unit level detector. A limit made up of Zener diode is also incorporated in the circuit to limit the rectified voltage to safe values even when the input current is very high under fault conditions. The measuring unit determines whether the quantity has attained the threshold value, that is set value, or not. When the input to the measuring unit is less than the threshold value, the output of the level detector is zero. For an instantaneous overcurrent relay, for I input less than I threshold, your I output is zero. For I input greater than I threshold, I output is present. In actual relay, I threshold can be adjusted. After operation of the measuring unit, the output is amplified by the amplifier. The amplified output is given to the output circuit to cause trip or alarm. So that was all about instantaneous overcurrent relay. Now we are going to discuss about IDMT relay or inverse definite minimum time relay. This is another type of relay. There are two types of relay. One is definite minimum time relay, and this is inverse definite minimum time relay. Those are different from one another, but definite minimum time relay is not in your course. Only inverse definite minimum time relay is there. So what is mean by definite minimum time relay? So definite minimum time means whenever the relay senses the fault, all the protective devices, they have the faulty current for some time. That is the definite time. Here the thing definite here written, definite minimum time. It means for certain amount of time, all the protective devices are under fault conditions. The relay, it allows the fault current to remain in all the protective devices for some time, for some definite time. That is why it is known as definite time relay. But here we are going to discuss about inverse definite minimum time relay. What is inverse definite minimum time relay? This is another type of relay. Here what happens? If more will be the current, if more severe will be the current, then faster will be the response of the relay. If more will be the severe of the faulty current, then faster will be the time, the sensing time. The relay will act very fast. So this is inverse definite minimum time relay. So more is the fault current, more fast it will work. So this is the working of a inverse definite minimum time relay. So as we can see, there are various blocks which works. Although these blocks are as simple as the previous one. So here we can see that the current which comes from the auxiliary CT is given to the rectifier. The current which is to be measured is given to the rectifier. So this is auxiliary. It means the current value is very very less. The value of the current which we get from the auxiliary is very very less. So that is rectified by the rectifier. Rectified means it is converted, that AC current is converted to DC current. That DC current is given to level detector 1. Here there is a preset value. Here it decides what is the fault current, if the input current has reached the fault current or not. So the already this value has been decided in level detector 1, where there is a preset value, and that preset value it decides whether the input current is beyond the fault current or not. If the input current is greater than the fault current, if the input current is greater than the fault current, then it will that output, then it will give the output to the timing circuit, which way then through timing circuit the output is given to the level detector 2. If the input current is more than the, if the input current is more than the fault current or the preset current, whatever we have decided in potentiometer in level detector 1, then the output is given to the level detector 2 through the timing circuit. Now what is this timing circuit? As I have discussed, as I have said in the previous, while opening this chapter, I said that this is a definite minimum time relay. Definite minimum means whenever a fault occurs in the system, the relay senses the fault and allows the fault current to flow for a sufficient minimum time, for a specific minimum time. For that reason it is named as definite minimum time relay. So this time can be adjusted, it can be increased or it can be decreased. So this time can be adjusted. This time can be adjusted by the timing circuit. So what is there inside the timing circuit? The timing circuit consists of resistor and capacitor. So this capacitor is charged by the voltage which is proportional to the current which is supplied from the level detector 1. So it takes some time. It takes some time by the capacitor to charge. So for that moment, for that time, it when it charges from 0 to whatever voltage the capacitor can hold, okay, for that moment the fault current is there in the circuit. And when this, when the capacitor voltage is equal to the threshold voltage which is already decided by the level detector 2, then the output is given to the amplifier. Here in the amplifier the output signal is enhanced, as we have discussed in the previous relay. Here the output signal is enhanced and that signal is given to the output circuit. Here in the output circuit there are tripping circuit is there, circuit breaker is there, which operates. So this is all about IDMT relay or inverse definite minimum time relay. So here we have two detector, one is level detector 1 and level detector 2. And as in the previous instant relay, instantaneous overcurrent relay, there was only one detector which works instantly whenever there is a fault. It starts to work instantly, there is a fault, suddenly it gives signal to the circuit breaker. Obviously it takes some nanosecond or some millisecond time to work, but instantly it works. But here in this IDMT relay, inverse definite minimum time relay, what happens? It takes some time. As it has been written, definite minimum time. It takes some time for the relay. The relay allows some time for the fault current to remain in the protective device. Thereafter, so these are all these rectifier, level detector 1, timing circuit. These are all the various parts of the inverse definite minimum time relay. So here, as we can say, that inverse definite minimum time, inverse definite means, what do you mean by inverse definite? Inverse definite means if more will be the current, more severity will be the current, then less time will be taken by the relay to operate. If the less is the current, then more time will be taken to operate. So as here we can see the graph here. This is a time graph. This is the actuating quantity. If the current value, if the voltage value is high, then it takes less time. If the current value is low, it takes more time. So this is the value of the graph. After that, whatever I have said, I have noted it in the next slide. You can note it down. Let me read once. The operating time of the inverse time overcurrent relays decreases with increasing fault current. Second point, for this relay with inverse time characteristics, the charging of the capacitor of the timing circuit takes place from voltage proportional to current. Then third, the current from the line city, which is reduced to 1 by 1000th by an auxiliary city, the auxiliary city has taps on the primary for selecting the desired pickup and current range, and its rectified output is simplified to level detector 1, that is overload level detector and an RC timing circuit. When the voltage on the timing capacitor VC attains the threshold value of the level detector 2, tripping occurs. The time delay given by the timing circuit shown in, this is the formula, this is the timing circuit, the time it is taken, that is given TC equals RC ln E by E minus VT, where VT is the threshold value of the level detector 2. By varying the values of R and C, the time can be varied without difficulties. The basic RC circuit can also be arranged in several series parallel combinations to have different values of T. Nonlinear resistors are used to have other time characteristics. Time delay overcurrent relays are used in overcurrent protection of utility equipment, distribution circuits, protection of transformer, generators, motors, etc. So this is all about the two types of relays which will come in your exam, and what are the advantage of static relay, this most often comes in your exam, and IDMT relay is a most important one. So take care, and as this is a one-way communication, I invite your queries through my WhatsApp number 8093-598-155. Thank you.